Good afternoon. Welcome to Ancient of Days Worship Center. We're doing something a little different here. I'm stepping out in great faith. We're going to have worship. The Lord has just kind of put it in my heart to start praising Him in a different way and putting myself out there. I will be using the laptop to assist me in vocals because I am learning to sing. So as we praise and worship the Lord, join me, whether you're standing, sitting, however you choose to worship God, worship Him. And please come back and visit. I hope I don't scare you. Thank you. Join us in worship.
Do it all you can do with one where the mountains move. When you breathe, the dead arise and the bones come back to life. There is power in this room where the Spirit of the Lord.
Praise you.
here again in the place we met, where hopelessness meets grace. Silence all the noise, every whispered lie cuts a whisper perfect peace. And even in my dark, I will not forget you are faithful still to me. I won't take a single step till I hear your voice. I surrender, and when my eyes cannot see, it's your voice that's leading me out of darkness and into light. It's your silence now. I'm holding on to your truth. I won't take a single step until I hear your voice. I surrender, and when my eyes cannot see, it's your you break the walls apart. You heal the wounded heart. I won't move until you speak. You calm the raging sea. You crush the enemy. I won't move until you speak. You break the walls apart. You heal. It's your love breaking through the night. I won't move until you speak, Lord. I won't move until you speak, Lord. I won't move until you speak.
Thank you. Thank you, Father. We just come before you today, this afternoon, with friends and family, Father, to come worship you. Oh, Lord, how we long for you, Lord. God, you are my God. You guide us, Lord. You watch over us, Lord. Father, as David said in his song, Lord, that his soul thirsts for you, that his flesh longed for you in a dry and desert land where there was no water. Lord, he cried out to you, Father, in a time where he felt lonely and troubled. But Lord, he called out to you, Lord, with a physical element, Lord, of his soul, Lord, that thirsts for you, and of his flesh that yearned and longed for you, Lord. And he also said that through your loving kindness, Lord, there is joy and there is fulfillment in you, Lord. So I pray for us today, whether our cup is full, maybe our cup has fallen over and is emptied out, Father, that we know, Lord, that your loving kindness, Lord, is better than life, that you fill us with joy and love and hope, because your loving kindness is better than life, Lord. So I lift up our hearts to you today. I lift up our souls to you, Lord. And I pray, Lord, that the word that goes forth, Father, will just be joy and peace into our hearts and our souls, Lord. And we praise you and we thank you. And all God's people said,
amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you.
Well, amen, church. What a beautiful evening that we have so we can just worship God. You know, one of my favorite parts is just getting into the Word of God and allowing it to penetrate our hearts. You know, as you turn to Exodus 19, turn with me to Exodus 19. And I encourage you this evening to take notes. The title of this evening's message is, Let's Soar Again, Church. Let's Soar Again. So Exodus 19, I'll give you a few seconds to get there. And God gave me this message as we were studying, doing a Bible study early in the morning, and we were looking at eagles. And God says, you know what? When all this is said and done, God's going to allow us to soar again higher than we've ever had before and just raise hands and worship him. So let's start in Exodus 19, verse 3, and we're going to stop at verse 14. Exodus 19, verse 3, all the way to 14. And Moses went up to God, and the Lord called to him from the mountain, saying, Thus you shall say to the house of Jacob, and tell the children of Israel, You have seen what I did to the Egyptians, how I bore you on eagle's wings, and brought you to myself. Now therefore, if you will indeed obey my voice and keep my covenant, then you shall be a special treasure to me above all people, for all the earth is mine, and you shall be to me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are the words which you shall speak to the children of Israel. So Moses came and called for the elders of the people and laid before them all these words which the Lord commanded him. Then all the people answered together and said, All that the Lord has spoken we will do. So Moses brought back the words of the people to the Lord. And the Lord said to Moses, Behold, I come to you in a thick cloud, that the people may hear when I speak with you and believe you forever. So Moses told the words of the people to the Lord. Then the Lord said to Moses, Go to all the people and consecrate them today and tomorrow, and let them wash their clothes, and let them be ready for the third day. For on the third day the Lord will come down upon Mount Sinai, in the sight of all people. You shall set bounds for the people all around, saying, Take heed to yourself that you do not go up to the mountain or touch its base. Whoever touches the mountain shall surely be put to death. Not a hand shall touch him, But he shall surely be stoned or shot with an arrow, whether man or beast, he shall not live. When the trumpet sounds, they shall come near the mountain. So Moses went down from the mountain to the people and sanctified the people, and they washed their clothes. Lord, we thank you, Father God, as we just get into your word this evening, Lord. We thank you, God, for every person that's watching on Facebook, those that are outside of New Mexico, Lord. We pray, Father God, that this word come alive in their heart, that it opens up, Father God, every avenue of their body, Father God, whether it's good or bad, Lord, and you begin to just touch them with your love, Father God. Give them hope and encourage them, Lord. As we get into this word, Father God, we will realize how important the word is as a foundation, Father God, to us as believers, to us as Christians. Lord, we just want to raise hands. We want to give you the glory right now as we get ready, Father God. Allow us to decrease and allow your word to increase in our hearts so that it can begin to overflow. And as it overflows, it doesn't go to waste. It touches those around us, our families, our co-workers, anybody in need of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Lord, we thank you for allowing us the freedom to proclaim the gospel to all nations. In Christ we pray, amen. So let me set the story here in Exodus 19. You know, in verse 1, it talks about that they were in the wilderness of Sinai. And we got to understand that it took them 3 months of trusting God to finally get to this wilderness of Sinai. And 3 months they began to rely on Christ. And they saw the deliverance that God used Moses to take them out of Egypt. And I love this. Not only did they see God take them out of Egypt, he began to give them the guidance that they needed. And they saw his glorious victory at the Red Sea. As the Egyptians were starting to swarm them, Moses just divided the Red Sea, and that was God's power and majesty. And then not only that, he provided the water and all the food that they needed. See, the 3 months that they hit this Mount Sinai, God was already in the midst. He was already providing. And one thing that I love in verse 1 is he gave them victory over the Amalekites. And that's a beautiful thing, as tonight he's getting ready to give you victory if you allow him to open up your heart. If you stand in agreement that his word is truth, you're going to see victory. You're going to see change. And I love this because listen to this. Sinai was the place where Moses had an encounter with the burning bush, right? And God was in the midst of that burning bush. And the whole nation of Israel would soon experience what Moses got to experience at Mount Sinai. And God gave me this thought. See, Moses was already there. So now he was going to take the people there with them in this chapter. Because see, we first have to get to a point in our walk as Christians to understand who God is in our life, the power and the authority that God has given us. And once we get to that position, then we can start bringing them along with us, those who have hope, those who have no hope, those who are in fear, any whatever situation it may be. Because the people could not go farther than their leader. And that's why it's so important this evening that we allow God to begin to burn deep inside our hearts. That we allow God's word to come alive. Because if we're going to lead our families that don't believe in Christ, maybe those who've gone astray, we need to lead them to the place that we've already been. And I have to say that again. The people could not go any further than their leader. See, if people are to know Jesus, it can only happen if we meet him first. And that's the thought that God gave me. See, when I had an encounter with Jesus and I surrendered my life to him, I was so excited, man. I wanted to tell everybody about this new Savior. And I remember everything that he began to do in my life. I just wanted to shout from the street corners and proclaim the name of Jesus. And that's what we're going to learn tonight. See, we can only bring people to Jesus if we in our hearts truly believe that he is the Savior of our lives, meaning that we are not in control of this life anymore. He is. So I want you to jump down to verse 4 with me in Exodus 19, and we're going to go verse upon verse. And I'm going to have you underline something because it's very important. You have seen what I did to the Egyptians, how I bore you on eagle's wings. Underline that. How I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. You know, this one verse right here is a whole sermon in itself. I want to share to you what bore you on eagle's wings is. See, God loved and care was shown for Israel already, that he began to bear them on eagle's wings. And it is said that an eagle is different from all other birds because birds take their young by their claws, but not an eagle. What an eagle does is the eagle allows the baby eagle to get on its back for protection, and it begins to soar through the skies. And I love this because if an arrow from a hunter goes to hunt that eagle, it's going to hit the mother first and protect the baby. So God gave me this thought about eagles. To bear on eagle's wings means to bestow freedom. It means courage to look ahead, church, to bring you to a place of renewed strength. And not only that, we begin to rest in his almighty strength. And I want to share with you what an eagle is. You know, an eagle at 40 years of age has a choice to make. It has a very difficult choice to make. And the decision that it has to make is either to go through a painful process of living another 30 years or just to go ahead and die. And the eagle that's 40 has to make this choice. And it's either going to go through this painful process or it's going to die. Let me share what an eagle has to do. Its flexible talons are no longer sharp where it can grasp the prey. And it needs it to be sharp so that it can hunt. And not only that, its beak becomes bent where it can no longer eat the prey that it captures. And the old feathers begin to stick to the chest of the old eagle at 40 years of age. And it makes it very difficult to fly. So the eagle is given a choice. The process that the choice the eagle has been given is 150 days, which is equivalent to 5 months. And it has to fly high to the mountaintop to begin a rebirth process that we call it today. So let me ask you something. That's the same thing that God is doing in us. He's given us a choice. He's given us a choice of rebirth. And see, the eagle's process of change, that it has to fly to the mountaintop. And once it gets to the mountaintop, the first thing that it has to do is it has to break its beak. So it begins to hit its beak up against a hard rock until the beak completely falls off. And then it waits till another beak grows. Listen to this process. And when the beak grows, it then begins to pull out its talons. And his talons are the same thing like our nails today. Can you imagine pulling out your nail one by one? So he begins the process of, now the beak is grown back and it's sharp and it's ready. He begins to pull out the talons one by one. And I love this. As the talons grow back, then he begins the third process. He begins to pluck its feathers out one by one to remove the old so that the new can take place. And after all this is done, after 5 months, it takes a flight that we call the famous flight of the rebirth. And then it gets to live another 30 years. Isn't that beautiful? After he has gone through all this painful process, God has given it another 30 years. And this is how good God is, that an eagle can only survive 150 days before it needs to eat again. And God timed it exactly right, where that eagle was done with the whole painful process in 150 days. And then he takes to the sky with new wings, with a new beak, with new talons. And that reminds me of when we come to Christ, how we came beat up, how we came rejected, how people didn't want us, people said we are no good, but we came to Christ and Christ began to rebirth us. Why? Because we began to ask him to come into our life. And yes, it's a painful process, but what happens when all that is said and done? The eagle gets to soar for 30 more years. And let me share this with you on an eagle. See, when a storm comes, most birds fly away from the storm. But what does an eagle do? He tilts its wings and he begins to fly into the storm. He begins to fly into the storm, and as the storm is beating him down, he begins to go higher and higher and higher. And finally, he is above the storm, looking down on it. And that's what Christ Jesus is for us this evening. We begin to walk with him. We begin to read his word. We begin to pray to him. We begin to be intimate with him. And before you know it, we were once in the storm, and now we are above the storm, looking down on it. I got to share something else with you. Go to Hebrews 12:2. I'm going to give you two verses, Hebrews 12:2. One of my verses that I've been reading that I'm actually falling in love with because it's really touched my heart, Hebrews 12:2. And it says that we fix our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and the perfecter of our faith, church. Got to read it again, Hebrews 12:2. We begin to fix our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and the perfecter of our faith. What a beautiful thing, right? As that eagle has left that mountaintop, he's no longer that 40-year-old eagle. He's got new feathers, he's got a new beak, he's got a new talon, and he's ready to hunt for another 30 years. And let me share with you, 2 Corinthians, Paul had it right in 5:17. It says, if a man should come to Christ, he or she is a new creation. And that's what this message needs to get us to do this evening. We need to begin to soar high above the storms of life. We need to begin to soar so high that in Hebrews 12, that our eyes are fixed on Jesus, because he's the pioneer and he's the perfecter of our faith, church. And then I'll give you another one to write down. Isaiah 40:31. Isaiah 40:31. And in Isaiah, he says, but those who wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary, and they shall walk and not faint. Did you catch that? But those who wait upon the Lord, that eagle had to fly to the mountaintop. He had a choice to die, right? But he had a choice to go through a painful process. So he chose to fly high to that mountaintop. And this verse comes alive, but those who wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not be faint. And the church says, amen. So as we get deeper into this word, you know what? God doesn't want you to be grounded anymore. He doesn't want you to be in those familiar places, those old memories, those bad habits. God wants you to begin to soar. And in order for you to begin to soar, you need to wait upon the Lord. You know, as you wait upon the Lord, he begins to renew your strength. And then he mounts you up like eagle's wings. And that's the topic of this message, is let's soar again. So go down to verse 5 of 19, Exodus. And in verse 5, chapter 19, it says, now therefore, if you will indeed obey my voice, underline obey my voice, and keep my command, my covenant, then you shall be a special treasure to me above all people, for all the earth is mine. There's three things I want you to underline as we get here. Obey my voice, keep my covenant, and then the word then. Because we first have to obey his voice, and we have to keep his covenant, and then we become, there it is, then we become that special treasure to God. So let's go back to verse 5. When he says that you shall be my special treasure, God intended Israel to be a special treasure unto him. He wanted them to be a people with a unique place in God's great plan, and people of great value and concern. And God says that they were his great treasure. And the meaning of the word treasure means something of great worth or value. A person esteemed to be rare and precious. And as we sit here and listen to this message, you need to look in the mirror and know that God has called you his special treasure. He didn't make anybody like you. You're just one, though you're the one and only one that he made. And not only did he make you, he sees you as rare and precious in his sight. See, just like God has a special place for the Israelites, he has a special place for us. And see, because the enemy knows that God considers us his special treasure. The enemy knows that. And why do you think the enemy is constantly coming at us with old habits, with old behaviors, you know, something that we tend to push aside and then we fall back to? See, the enemy knows that if he can keep you in a place where, you know what, you're just beat up, you know, you feel like you're no good, nobody wants you, nobody loves you, then the enemy is winning the battle. But see, the enemy knows that you are special and you are rare in God's sight. And in verse 5, that's why God says to the church, obey my voice. Obey my voice and keep my covenant. And we're going to learn what the word covenant means. But see, when we obey his voice and we keep his covenant, then the word then comes in. Then you are my special treasure. Listen, a special treasure. I love what the Apostle Paul said in Ephesians 1:18. You can write it down. The Apostle Paul said in Ephesians 1:18, Paul longed for Christians to know how great a treasure that we were to God. He prayed that we would know what are the riches of the glory of his inheritance to all the saints. See, Paul had it right. Paul knew that we were this special treasure and how much God loved us and how much God adored us. Because he went on to say that, what are the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints? What are they? We are his treasure. We belong to God, and the enemy knows that. So you know what? Next time you think that you're no good, next time you think that, you know what, you keep failing and you're never going to succeed, look in the mirror. And don't look at the reflection that comes back to you. Look at what God has prepared you to be. Look at how much God loves you, how much God thinks of you, how much God wants to be intimate with you. And then you can push what we call all the haters aside, and you can look in the mirror and say, you know what, God? You made me as your special treasure. And in order for me to achieve that, going back to verse 5, I need to begin to obey your voice, Lord. I need to begin to keep your covenant. And the best place to hear the voice of God is never audible for me. It's always in my heart. It's when I open up the Word of God and I begin to read it, and the verse comes alive to me, like that verse, he bore me on eagle's wings. And I'm like, Lord, what does that mean? And he took me to study what eagles were all about, what they did. And what they said, that an eagle only mates once. He has his mate for a lifetime. And you know what? Even the eagle is given a hard choice, as we have been given in life. But the only difference is we tend to forget that God goes before us if we allow him to. So Paul longed to make the people understand how great of a treasure that they were. And then verse 5, where he says, obey my voice and keep my covenant. See, all this was promised to the Israelites when they left Egypt under one condition. They were God's treasure, but they had to keep the covenant, and they had to obey his voice, and they had to remain in God's word. And this is what I want to talk to you this evening. We have to remain in God's word this evening. It can't just be a fad that we're going through because we have nothing better to do. It has to be a lifestyle. And then that lifestyle begins to lead into a legacy. And before you know it, it's spreading. It's contagious. It's touching our family. It's touching everybody that we come in contact with. Because the first thing they want to say is, what happened? You're not that person you used to be. You're not that drunk on the street corner. You're not that druggie in some drug house. You're not that person that always had something negative to say. You're not the liar. You're not the thief. What happened? And then you can begin to say, I realize that if I obeyed the voice of God and I remained in his covenant, that I am a special treasure to him. And guess what? That's when we began to show the enemy, you know what? No longer can you tell me I'm no good, because my God tells me that I am, that I'm his special treasure. See, they had to remain in God's word. And as long as they remained in God's word, he began to change their life. He began to fulfill their destiny. And that's why, Christians, tonight, we are to remain in God's word. We can't just wait for a Wednesday night service, a Sunday morning service, a Sunday evening. We have to ask God, give me the desire to burn. Allow me to open up your word. When I wake up in the morning, the first thing I want to do is just hear your lovely thoughts about me. And before I go to bed, I just want to spend some time with you. See, the word covenant, and write this down. The Lord was about to enter a covenant with Israel as a whole, as he has entered a covenant with us through Jesus Christ. Let me give you the example of a covenant. A biblical covenant is a spiritual created bond. And I'll say that again. A biblical covenant is a spiritual created bond. God intended to enter a binding relationship with Israel making him their own possession. The covenant was greater than the law itself. I got to say that again. God intended to enter a binding relationship with Israel, making them his own possession. You know why most churches do an altar call? Because God has given us an opportunity to allow you to make that covenant with him, to allow you to come or stand up wherever you may be, at the work, in the living room, maybe you're cooking dinner for the family. And when God calls that altar call, that's what he wanted with Israel. He wanted to tell them, you know what? If you make this binding contract with me, you become mine. You're my own special treasure. And it's like the eagle. Like I said, most birds would carry their young in their talons, but not the eagle. The eagle says, tells the young eaglet, get on my back and I will soar through the skies. And as long as you're on my back, you're protected. Well, that's what God is calling out to his children tonight. Church, whatever you may be, mom, dad, uncle, aunt, grandpa, grandma, I want to make a biblical covenant with you. I want to be able to call you my own special treasure. And see, that covenant that God made with them was greater than the law itself. The covenant God would make with Israel involved the law in the Old Testament. It involved sacrifice and the choice to obey to be blessed, here it is, or disobey and be cursed. And that was the law of the Pentateuch, the five books, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. But now we have Jesus who has came on the scene. And when Jesus came on the scene, we no longer have to make those sacrifices. We no longer have to do those rituals. God has opened up heaven so that we may have direct access to the Father. And that's whenever we feel like we're no good, or whenever we feel like we're just defeated, wherever you may be, you can stop. And you can look your eyes to the heavens and say, God, I know that I'm your special treasure. God, I know that you call me your own. Father God, help me to get through this storm. And God might say, put your wings tilted because you're going to go through the storm. But little do you know, as you're going through the storm, I'm elevating you above the storm. And once you're above the storm, you can begin to teach those who are getting ready to enter a storm in their life. See, that covenant was from God, the same covenant that God sent his only begotten Son, that he would have to go through all the temptations that this world had to throw at him. He had to go through all the ridicule. You know, the people told him he was no good, and they mocked him and they made fun of him, the same way that the world has done to us and continues to do to us. But the only thing is, God was on a mission, and God's eyes was not focused upon man. He was focused upon the cross, because he knew when he got on the cross and the world began to say, we defeated the so-called savior of the world, God says, no, it's only begun. You have not defeated. You have woke up a sleeping giant, and now there is a revival that is coming on the land, because my children no longer have to worry about sickness and sin. Because all they have to do is come into this biblical covenant with me and call out to me, and I will tell them that they're my own special treasure, that they belong to me. Go to verse 6 of chapter 19. And you shall be with me a kingdom of priests. Underline a kingdom of priests. And a holy nation. These are the words which you shall speak to the children of Israel. In verse 6, he says, you shall be to me a kingdom of priests. When's the last time that the world told you that you're just a beautiful daughter of the Most High God, you're a king, that you know you are holy? But see, in verse 6, he says, you shall be to me, capital M-E, which is God, a kingdom of priests. See, God intended for Israel to be a kingdom of priests, church, where every believer could come before God. Catch this. They could come before God, and they could bring those with them before God, and they could represent God to all the nations. And that's why we have to begin to soar high, so that when we leave this place that we're in, we can begin to be a representative to who God is and how God got us through, and how God provided us, and how God fed us, and how God paid our bills. We need to proclaim to all the nations what God did for us and give them the honor and glory due to his name. See, that's the opportunity that they had. I got to read it again. God intended for Israel to be a kingdom of priests, where every believer could come before God themselves and everyone could represent God to all the nations. Now we have Jesus Christ, like I said, who has given us direct access. And why do you think most people don't use that? Because they don't feel worthy. They feel that they haven't made good decisions in their life. But I'm here to tell you that that's wrong. Because Christ made all the decisions upon the cross of Calvary so that we wouldn't have to. All we have to do, church, is be quick to repent. Whenever we fail, whenever we sin, whenever we fall short of the glory, all we have to do is be quick to repent to God. And God, through Jesus Christ, we have access to his holy kingdom, which is in heaven. See, I love what Peter reminds us, and you can write this down and read it later. In 1 Peter 2:9, Peter reminds us in 1 Peter 2:9 that we are a royal priesthood. We are a royal priesthood. And this is the New Testament. He says, guys, you know what? I'm going to paraphrase it. He's looking upon the people and saying, you know what, guys? You are a royal priesthood. Don't let nobody tell you that you're not. You are royal. Why? Because we belong to the King of all kings. And then in Revelation 1:6, write it down. Revelation 1:6. And he has made us kings and priests to his God and Father. To him be the glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Got to read that again. And he has made us kings and priests to his God and Father. To him be the glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. You tell me that's not a promise. You tell me that we're not royal. And see, the enemy knows that. And the enemy knows that if he can keep us with that stinking thinking, we forget who we belong to. We forget that God made us royal, that we are his own special treasure. And in verse 6, where he goes on to say, and a holy nation. And let's read it again so I don't lose you. You shall be to me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. See, God intended for Israel to be a holy nation as he intends for us this evening to be holy in his sight. A nation and people set apart from the rest of the world. And I love what scripture says, that we are not citizens of this world. Why? Because this world hates us, church. This world can't bear to look upon us because when it does, it knows that we are that royal priesthood, that we belong to the King of all kings. And that's exactly what God says, that we are a holy nation. We are a peculiar people. Why? Because we belong to God. We are his possessions, and we are fit for his purpose, not ours. See, because we belong to him, we are fit for his purpose. Our master, if he leaves the house, we do whatever the master tells us to do. If he leaves us as steward over the house to take care of his affairs, to take care of his home, we have to do what he tells us to do, right? It's the same way with Christ Jesus. In order for us to be that treasure and belong to him the way he wants us to, we have to obey what he tells us to do. And where do I get that, Pastor? Where do I learn to begin to obey what he wants from me? In his word. In his word. And through his word, he will establish that biblical covenant with you. Because he wants us to be holy. Another thing Peter reminds us in 1 Peter 2:9. He reminds us that holy nation, his own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into the marvelous light. See, God has called us out of darkness, and we're going to have an opportunity this evening. Or guess what? If you're in darkness, that's okay. If you haven't been following Christ, that's okay. If you haven't been reading your word, that's okay. Because God is getting ready to move. Why? Because we belong to him. And when God begins to move, it's not because he wants to take away your freedoms, because he wants to call you his own. And that's why Peter reminds us we are that holy nation, his own special people. We belong to God. And you know what? As we belong to God, God begins to go on behalf. So let me share this with you. Let's jump down to verse 10 because I want to get there on Exodus 19. Then the Lord said to Moses, go to the people and consecrate them today and tomorrow and let them wash their clothes. And I had to really dig deep on that. See, God has given them a chance to prepare themselves. Because he tells Moses, go to the people and consecrate them today and tomorrow. He's given them a time to prepare themselves. Why? Because they're getting ready to meet God on the top of the mountain. They're getting ready to see the glory of God. See, God was going to appear to Israel in a spectacular fashion. And before all this could happen, he told Moses, get the people to prepare their hearts. Get them to go and take a bath, clothe themselves. And let me share this with you. We cannot continue to go on as Christians, if we are Christians, and continue to live the same lifestyle. Because you know what? The Word of God says that we will be held accountable for that. There is no excuse to come in front of God and says, oh Lord, I just liked it, or I couldn't stop doing it. Because God's going to say, no, I've given you every opportunity and every tool through my word that, you know what? No, you couldn't stop it, but I could. And a lot of times we don't stop something because we don't want to stop what we're doing. If we had faith in God, God would stop it for us. But it's just like that eagle. It takes a painful process. And not all the times it's just going to happen overnight. It's a process. And this is why he told the people, go and have them prepare themselves. Why? Because God was getting ready to have an encounter with them. Beautiful. No difference than we, this evening, have to begin to prepare ourselves to await the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. Go to Revelation 6:15. Revelation 6:15. We, this evening, have to begin to prepare ourselves because we don't know when God is coming. But can I tell you something? Tonight, we have the opportunity to prepare our hearts, our minds. You know, God shared with me as we were praying this morning that, you know, God's ready to break down every stronghold, every addiction, every sickness, everything. But he can't break down that which you won't let him break down. And the scary part is we will be accountable for what we're not willing to do. In Revelation 16:15, it says, behold, I am coming like a thief. Blessed is the one who stays awake, keeping his garments on, that he may not go about naked and be seen exposed. I got to read that again. Behold, I am coming like a thief. Blessed is the one who stays awake, keeping his garments on, that he may not go about naked and be seen exposed. That's what God is doing right now in this process. And you know what? I know a lot of people think I'm crazy, but this has been a great opportunity, not only for me and my family, not only for the church that I pastor, for all of us. Why would you say it's a great opportunity? Because it's allowed us to get closer to God. You know what? I've opened my word more than I had time to open it. You know, working full-time and pastoring full-time, I didn't have all the time that I needed to open the word. Now I do because I understand that we need to be prepared. As Moses said in verse 10, and we'll read it again. Then the Lord said to Moses, go to the people and consecrate them today and tomorrow, and let them wash their clothes. Verse 11, and let them be ready for the third day. For on the third day, the Lord will come down upon Mount Sinai in the sight of all people. Wow. Can you imagine that? God just didn't come like a thief in the night, like he's going to do in our present time. He gave them an opportunity to prepare themselves. And can I tell you, that's why we as a church give you an opportunity to prepare yourselves. We always do an altar call because that's the most important part of the sermon, is to make sure that you're prepared, because he does say he does come as a thief. And we have to prepare ourselves. And let me share something with you. It's a painful process. I've gone through it. You've gone through it. And sometimes we've just given up halfway through it, but that's okay. Because God gives us a do-over. He says, okay, you know what? You gave up this time. You might have gave up the 100th, 1,000th time, but I'm giving you another opportunity. Let's jump down to verse 12. And we begin to close. And in verse 12, it says, you shall set bounds for the people all around, saying, take heed to yourself that you do not go up to the mountain or touch its base. Whoever touches the mountain shall surely be put to death. This is where we talk about reverential fear of the Lord. See, we have lost that in 2020. We don't see God as being holy. And God has set boundaries all around around us, but we don't ever know those boundaries because we don't ever study what His Word says. We don't know what the Word of God says. And then when we hit a dead end or we go off a cliff, we're like, okay, God, how come you let me go off the cliff? How come you didn't tell me? And God says, the same way I told the children in Israel, don't go up the mountain because it is holy ground. You are to have fear for the Lord. He says, because I'm getting ready to appear to you. And when I appear to you, I've given you an opportunity to get your life right. And verse 12 says, you shall set bounds for the people all around. What does that mean? It means that the coming of God to Mount Sinai did not mean that the people were free to go to the mountain and fellowship with them. No. They had to keep their distance behind the barrier, and the penalty for failing to keep their distance was death. You know the only thing that keeps me from going out and acting a fool and doing the things I used to like to do? Because I know that when God comes and He catches me naked, like Revelation said, and what is going to be my excuse? Oh Lord, nobody ever told me, or God, you know, that's not going to be an excuse. God's going to say, you know what, I gave you every opportunity to prepare yourselves because I told you in my book that I was coming like a thief in the night. And see, right now, the seed has been planted, church. You are given this opportunity because you've heard this word to allow God to begin to clothe you in royalty, to take off all the filthy clothing, to take off everything that rebels itself against God, and to begin to clothe yourself in His royalty. Got a few more. The regulations were meant to have revealed to Israel how special and holy this mountain was. Why? Because God resided on it. And I gotta share this with you. When God lives in your heart, you are holy and special. And we can't allow the enemies to break those barriers. Why? Because He doesn't belong. Because it's not His. He's stepping on private property. Because when God lives in your heart, He has no access to you anymore. And that's exactly what the Word of God is saying. You know what? There's an event taking place on this mountain. I'm getting ready to reveal myself to you. As I'm doing that, you need to keep your distance. Because as you keep your distance, you're going to get to look upon me. And in Luke 15:10, it says this, Luke 15:10, likewise I say to you that there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. I got to say that again. Likewise, I say to you that there is joy in the presence of the angels of God when one sinner repents. See, God showed Israel that obedience is more important than their feelings. And that's what we have to dig deep. Obedience to God is more important than our feelings. When we don't doubt some of that, look at the Israelites. What took a 3-day journey took 40 years. See, God's not doing that anymore. God has given us ample opportunity to just to surrender to Him. And on verse 16, and I close, and we'll get into a worship song. And then it came to pass on the third day in the morning that they were thunderings and lightnings and a thick cloud on the mountain, and the very sound of the trumpet was loud so that all the people who were in the camp trembled. And Moses brought the people out of the camp to meet with God. Wow, and they stood at the foot of the mountain. You know, can you imagine? I was told this for so many times. When the trumpet blows, it reminds me of when a person comes to Christ. You know, when a person comes to Christ, it says all heaven rejoice. All heaven begins to rejoice. So the opportunity we have now as we close in this worship song, as I remain up here and worship with you, I'm going to do an altar call. So I want you just to stay wherever you're at. Stand up if you choose. Sit down. But I want you to close your eyes and just lift your hands to God and see what He's getting ready to do. Thank you. Continue to remain in the heart of worship as we just speak to the people that are watching. You know, so many years in ministry, I've always learned that this is the most important part of the service, and most people would have already left after the word was given. But now, those of you that are watching, we have an opportunity. And those that are saved, come in agreement with me You know, I've been receiving lots of texts on Messenger, on our Facebook page, on our email. And you know what? I don't believe in coincidence. I don't believe in luck. What I believe in is I stand upon the Word of God. And as long as I stand upon the Word of God, God says that, you know what? Those of you that have reached out to us, those of you that continue to send us messages, let me tell you, God is reaching out and God is touching your heart. And you know what? God wants you to know that He wants you to come back to Him. And before Facebook cuts me off, I know that if you have sent a request for scriptures, for, you know what, prayer, let me tell you that this is your opportunity this evening to just raise your hand and surrender to Him so that you can begin to walk according to Him, so that you can begin to receive that calling of His treasure, royal priesthood. So if that's you, don't worry about who's around you. Just lift up your hand and say, that's me. And make sure you let us know that when you come to God so that we can continue to pray for you. I want you to repeat four words. God, come into my life. Let's repeat that. God, come into my life. It's not hard. It's not difficult. It's very simple. If you said, God, come into my life, you have opened up the door so God can come in. And you need to let us know so that we can begin to pray, so that we can begin to stand in agreement with you, because God is taking back what belongs to Him. Amen. We'll see you on Wednesday, 7 p.m. We love you, and God bless.